and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Fell, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. When was the last time that you used cash to pay for something? Were you able to save money during the pandemic? And if so, what do you plan on doing with it? Did you perhaps buy a few too many packages online during lockdown? And will you be partaking in this year's Black Friday sales? Welcome to another episode of the Future Report podcast. These are some of the questions that we are going to be discussing in today's episode and sharing our research about. And joining me today to do that is McCrindle's Managing Director, Sophie Renton. Soph, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks so much for having me, Ash. It's so much fun to be back.
You were an amazing guest in our previous episode that we had you on about well-being and work from home. And we're talking about a very interesting topic today about online shopping and Black Friday and how our, I guess, as consumers, how our behavior has and is changing. And I asked a few questions at the beginning just then to our listeners to get them thinking about this topic. And so I want to pose the same questions to you, Soph. So do you remember the last time that you used cash to pay for something?
I actually have absolutely no idea of the last time that I used cash to pay for something. I'm definitely the phone girl now. I barely even carry my wallet anywhere.
Yes, I am the same, actually. I feel like I was a little bit late to adapt the tap and go payments. And then as soon as I did, I was like, why didn't I do this sooner? It's so convenient and so easy. And for me, it was interesting on the weekend. I actually went to Starbucks. And as you know, so I've got my first Christmas Starbucks drink, which is exciting. And the people before me were lining up to pay with cash. And I was shocked. I was like, I haven't seen anyone pay with cash for ages. And even I think about like the farmers markets, you know, where traditionally it's like, oh, I've got to go get cash out to pay for things. Now everyone's got tap and go things. Like it's everywhere. So it's certainly, I think, changed over time. What about online shopping, Soph? Did you do a lot of that during lockdown?
Guilty as charged. I maybe did just a little bit too much of the online shopping, but hey, it was the moments that the knock at the door, the excitement. Actually, in my defense, maybe this is just me trying to cover for it, but I actually purchased a few of those things that I had put off, you know, when they're like, oh, they're not essential, but then it's like, hey, I'm not spending money on my coffee or a dinner out. So like maybe now is that moment to get that purchase. But yes, I did do a little bit too much online shopping.
Okay. And what was your favorite purchase then?
Oh, tricky. I probably am one of the rare people in lockdown that didn't spend my entire life in activewear. I did on the weekends when you could go out and go walking. So I did buy some activewear, but probably my favorite purchase was actually a new pair of jeans.
Very nice. And I guess for me, I actually didn't do that much online shopping during lockdown in terms of clothing and things like that. But I did get some really fun, beautiful like champagne glasses. And I did get some like really boutique bougie wine delivered to my house. I thought, oh, you know, sometimes just need to celebrate the small wins. I had my birthday in lockdown. So, you know, some of those things are my favorite purchases. But yes, it has been an interesting time with lockdown and changing our behavior and even with how we shop and how we pay for things, which is the topic of today's podcast. And again, we've talked a lot about the impact of COVID over all the episodes that we've done so far, because it has just been so transformative to our lives and to our behavior. And so if I wanted to ask you if you could give us a bit of a snapshot around people's finances and financial health, where are people at in terms of their behavior and their sentiment towards their finances sort of, you know, during COVID now, I guess, in a little bit of a post-COVID environment, where are we at? What is the research saying?
Yeah, Australians and finances is a really interesting topic. It's not one that we typically talk about that often. So research is actually really powerful to give a snapshot of where Australians are at, where they may be a little bit more honest than they would be if they're going to tell someone direct. And what we've actually found in our research is that the number one regret of Australians is not prioritizing their financial health earlier in life. I know you and I have had some conversations about this at different points where we, you know, look with information that we have now and go, oh, why didn't we apply this earlier in life? But there are moments where it is, you live in the context that you have. But that is the number one regret of Australians, is not prioritising their financial health earlier. And we can see how that's starting to play out in Australians' lives, because more than half of Australians actually have $5,000 or less in their savings account right now, and a fifth have less than $100. So it's not necessarily a great picture for some Australians in terms of their financial security and how they are coping with their finances. One of the positives, though, is that there is starting to be a little bit of a shift with some of the younger generations prioritizing their financial health. They've learned from the generations that have gone before, and even as they think about super and retirement for those that are 18 to 26, they are much more engaged than the older generations. And they're thinking about their super, they're checking it at least monthly. I knew I was talking about this morning, so I even jumped on and checked my super today because I was like, oh, where is that at? I should pay attention to that. So the younger generation are becoming more financially savvy and more aware of their finances and placing a greater priority on that because they've learned from the generations that have gone before. But if we consider the last couple of years and maybe what that has done to Australians' finances, for some, they lost their jobs or their businesses have slowed down. They've had to close their doors. It has been an incredibly challenging season for many Australians. And so some have been financially worse off. For a number of Australians, however, they've actually had an opportunity to save more. We often talk about the memes that go around, but there was that meme that said that, you know, at the start of COVID, okay, I found out all I ever did was buy coffee, shop online and, you know, go out to dinner, because now, wow, I'm not spending any money on that anymore. And so Australians have found a way to save during this time. And that's actually been quite positive that has come out of it. But COVID hasn't impacted everybody equally.
Yeah, it's really important to acknowledge that, I think. And those stats that you shared at the beginning of that answer are quite sobering, that there is a large proportion of Australians who don't have much in the way of a financial safety net. So that's hopefully, as we shine a light on that with our research, that can be something that people are made aware of. And like you said, for the younger generations to go, okay, there's the research is saying there are older Australians who are saying they regret not prioritising their financial savings earlier. And so the younger generations are listening, which is great to hear. And they're going, okay, I need to be aware of what's going on with my finances. And if I want to have the great Australian dream of, say, home ownership, which we know is still quite strong among the emerging generations, then they need to be thinking about checking their super and being aware of their financial behaviour. And yeah, again, COVID has not treated us all equally, which is really important to acknowledge, as you said. But hopefully it's been able to shine a light on that topic because, yeah, it's not something that we often talk about. It's maybe something that we're not taught about when we're young at school, and yet it's something that we need to know how to manage and look after for our whole life, and it does impact other areas of our lives. But it is great, I think, that research does suggest younger generations are looking at those stats and those things about their life, and they're maybe a little bit more financially conservative as a result of COVID. And for those of us who have saved in COVID, as you mentioned, so if as a result of lockdowns and not being able to travel or have big expenses or go out as much, does the research suggest anything about what people are looking maybe to do with their savings if they have been able to save during the pandemic?
Yeah, well, the number one thing that Australians are wanting to spend their hard-earned safe finances on is travel. The closed borders have not curbed Australians' desire. In fact, it may have enhanced it, particularly for the younger generations whose gap years have been stalled and they've had to, you know, stay within the bounds of Australia. So Aussies are looking to travel, whether that is regional, interstate or internationally. As soon as they're allowed, they will be out of here and going on those travel journeys. Others, however, are taking a slightly more practical approach with their savings and paying down debt or growing their retirement fund. But a number are buying property, and we have all seen the property market go crazy because of that. But there are a number of Australians that are choosing to put their additional savings into the property market.
Yes. And you did mention that travel runs deep in the Australian psyche. And I think if anything, with the closed borders that we've experienced over the last 18 months to 2 years, it's probably just ingrained that love and desire even further. Unprompted question, Soph, but where are you planning to travel anywhere? Where's the first place you kind of want to go when all the restrictions ease?
Yeah, when all the restrictions ease, I am a Kiwi. So thank you, Australia, for adopting me. So I will be going home to see my family. That is the first international trip I'll be going on.
Oh, that would be so special. And yeah, you really, I think all of our hearts go out to those who have been separated from their families because of the border closures. So, and the travel industry plays such an important role, and they've just been so hardly hit in the last couple of years. And yeah, I'm sure all of us are ready to make those trips and even pack the empty esky and go, you know, to regional locations to sort of help places that really rely on tourism continue to thrive in the future. Okay, so that's a little bit of a snapshot of Australians and people's financial health and what we've kind of, what our priorities are in that area. When we think about online shopping and our behavior changes as a result of the pandemic, I think it's fascinating because there is, even prior to the pandemic, there was a lot of talk about the world and Australia, for example, becoming a cashless society. And we sort of pointed to that earlier, like, can you remember the last time that you used cash? You made a great observation, Soph, that with contactless payments through our devices, we don't even need to carry wallets anymore. And we often say for the emerging generation of young people like Generation Alpha, they may never actually own a wallet because all their payments will be contactless and digital. So it's interesting to think about our behavior changes. And again, I think COVID's really accelerated that. Even when you went into a shopping center and you press the button for a parking ticket, now it's kind of the gesture control where you just wave your hand over it. So again, it's accelerated a trend we were already seeing. What do people think about cashless society? And we've asked a few questions. Where are people's thinking around that in terms of whether we will become a cashless society into the future?
Yeah, it's a great question, Ash. And our research shows that people are very open to this, with 7 in 10 actually agreeing that Australia will be a cashless society by 2031. So that's just in the next decade that people are expecting Australia to no longer be a place where cash is used. And the data actually 100% supports this, with card payments 2.4 times what they were a decade ago. So if we look at some of the data from 2007, which, fun fact, was the year that Steve Jobs announced the iPhone, which is now what we, so many of us use for those digital contactless payments. But in 2007, almost 70% of payments were cash. And today that has flipped, with almost 2 in 3 payments are card payments. So our history is showing us that we are shifting from cash to card payments. And over the next decade, Australians and the globe around us is actually saying, yep, we are, we're going in the direction of the digital contactless payments. And that, I think, is actually quite exciting because it opens up a number of different opportunities for consumers and organizations, and just the ease of those frictionless experiences that we have when we have that integration of digital into our lives.
Yes, and it's exactly what you just said. It's easy, it's convenient. And even with, I mean, something that we were really encouraged to do, and even on my, if I reflect on my personal experience during the pandemic, I didn't want to be going into the shops because we were encouraged to stay home, especially during the Sydney lockdown that we both experienced. And online shopping, grocery shopping, just became so convenient. And something that a few people in my life had said, oh, you got to try online shopping groceries. And I was like, yep, I'll do it one day. But for now, I'm just going to duck into the shop whenever I need something. It's super easy. And then I started doing click and collect orders, and I'm like, this is amazing. I feel like I'm getting time back in my day. And I mean, you've got to be a little bit more planned and organized because you kind of got to do it. You can't just do it instantaneously. You kind of got to do it the day before or a few hours before. But online shopping, yeah, it does offer some great benefits to us. So do you think online shopping is here to stay? So if once, again, all the restrictions lift, and maybe even when we don't have to wear masks in the near future when we go shopping, like when we kind of resume what we maybe knew before the pandemic in the way that we shopped, do you think people will still change their behavior and modify that to shopping online?
Absolutely, Ash. The last decade has seen significant shifts in consumer behavior. And one of the most significant has probably actually been the rise of online shopping, with the the ease of that, that it has, as you said, won back time to people's lives. And so I believe it is here to stay. And so many people actually agree, with 2/3 expecting to purchase more online than in store into the future. So online purchases, I believe, will actually almost become our default or our first preference over potentially going to the bricks and mortar stores.
Yeah, and it's that convenience is just hard to sort of combat, and it is so easy and it's quick and you get more time in your day. So if that's the case, Sophie, if people are going to shop more online in the future, it's going to become a regular habit of ours that we, you know, developed and was ingrained over the last couple of years and now is here to stay. What do you think that means for the shopping centre, the place that we go to do our groceries or to try clothes on or whatever it might be? Do you think they will still play a role in the future if people are shopping online more?
I actually think they will. I know that might be a different thought for people because, you know, if the online shopping is here and it's cheaper to just have an e-commerce store, so why do we need that bricks and mortar store? But what we've seen is that 72% of Australians actually still enjoy the in-store shopping experience. So there's still a place for the bricks and mortar experience and the tangible experience. So shops themselves, there will be an element of them, but I believe it's a time of reinvention where we are not just looking at how do we recreate an experience, but how do we create a completely new experience? What experience is it that's going to require people to come down and come to the shopping centre? And additionally, from other research that we've conducted, we've actually found that the shopping centre is one of the hubs of our communities. It's one of the gathering points that creates that human experience and draws people together. So we've even seen that with how shopping centres have adapted already. You often see that the coffee shops and the eateries are placed at the centre, and they've actually shifted their focus to how do we create shopping as an experience and not just a transaction. So I think there is definitely still a future for the shopping centre, but it will look different. And in some ways, I'm quite excited about what innovations could come out of us requiring to think differently.
Yeah, that's so true. I love that perspective. And yeah, that research you shared, I really think about that in my own life, in terms of the shopping centre being a really key part of the community. And for me, I was sharing this, I think, with some of our team the other day, like at Christmas time, I love going to the shops. I love getting my Starbucks gingerbread latte and walking around and seeing the decorations and the vibe and the atmosphere. And sometimes, though, I do love to do my shopping online, especially around Christmas, because it can be chaotic. But if I've built that time into my day, sometimes it's a really pleasurable experience. I might meet someone for a coffee, and, you know, what we need out of the shopping experience, like you said, might change. And I love that in terms of the reinvention and the repurposing and the reimagining as to what can take place and how shopping centres can enable people to thrive. And I guess I even think about maybe perhaps older Australians, or maybe people who are a little bit more isolated, that the shopping centre can be that place where they have that human interaction that some of us maybe take for granted, but that we might get from our workplaces or other spheres of our life. But the shopping centre can be the heart of someone's community and can facilitate more than just where they, you know, go to purchase something. So it'd be really interesting to see how they shift in the future.
100%. And particularly with our return to local, that's one of the other trends that we've been seeing, is that people are increasingly wanting to know that they're local producers of food or products, and that sense of community that comes with local. And so the shopping centre can actually facilitate that return to local as well. People are increasingly wanting to understand the supply chains of their products and where they've come from. So I think online definitely will continue into the future as one of our defaults. But I think, you know, we often talk about the trends and the counter trends, that the shopping centre will still have its place as that hub of community and really facilitating that return to local.
Absolutely. And exactly as you just shared then, also, so far, I was reflecting on our first episode of the podcast, where I was interviewing Mark McCrindle about being a futurist and how do we predict future trends and what do we consider when we do that. And when we think about something like the future of the shopping centre, yes, the technological trend is, like, with technology, it enables us to do online shopping, and that's convenient and that's easy. And we just discussed that's probably going to continue in the future. Absolutely. Our statistics support that. But then you've got other trends like the human-centric trend and what do we need for our society and for us as humans to thrive and to flourish and to connect. And yeah, the shopping center might change as a result of it, depending on sort of which trend you look through the lens of. So it's really fascinating. And speaking of Christmas and shopping, this coming Friday is Black Friday, which if you don't know what that is, and you're going to share some stats on this in a moment, I know, Soph, but if you don't know, it's the Retail Super Day, which is very popular in the United States. And in the United States, it's the day following the Thanksgiving public holiday. And in some American states, I believe, it's actually an additional holiday. So it's quite a big deal overseas. And all of this has combined to make it the unofficial start to the Christmas shopping season, where there's lots of sales and lots of discounts. And apparently it's the biggest single shopping day of the year, especially, again, in the United States. And it's been really interesting because we have been conducting research about, here in Australia, people's awareness and perception of this shopping day and whether they know about it, whether they intend to make the most of the sales that are taking place. Soph, could you tell us a little bit about what the research says as to if Australians are planning on making the most of it and if they're aware of it, that it's coming this Friday?
Yeah, Australians are definitely growing in their recognition of what Black Friday is. Back in 2017, actually, we conducted a study and asked Australians if they were aware of what Black Friday was. And one in four Australians at that point had never heard of Black Friday. And we ran that same question just a couple of weeks ago. And that proportion is now only 2% have never heard of Black Friday sales. So the recognition is definitely growing. And so too is the taking advantage of that, with half of Australians having heard of the sales and planning that they're going to definitely make some purchases, and some are at least just going to check them out. And that's up from 2 in 5 last year. So it is growing, the recognition of it and the engagement with it. And it's particularly our younger generations, our Gen Zs and our Gen Ys, they love their online purchase, they love their online shopping, and they are the ones that are really driving this trend of engaging in the Black Friday sales.
Yeah, I feel like I have become more aware of it alongside our research. And as a millennial, as I know you are, Soph, as well, you know, there's just been, for me, even just in my life anecdotally, I've seen a lot more promotion of the Black Friday sales, and maybe even that the younger generations are very online on social media and impacted by, you know, influencers based in the United States. It kind of trickles down to us, geographically. And then, yeah, in the land down under, we are making the most of these Black Friday sales and launching into the Christmas season, which, again, for a lot of retailers who may have been hard hit by the pandemic, I imagine many this year are looking forward to promoting sort of that kind of consumer spend as we launch into the Christmas season. Oh, yeah, you go, Soph.
Sorry, I was just going to say they definitely are, because 2 in 5 Australians actually are planning to use the Black Friday sales to kickstart their Christmas shopping, which is great news to some of those retailers that have had to have their doors closed. And 3 in 10 are actually expecting to spend more in the Black Friday sales than they ever have before. So Australians are really starting to look to the Black Friday sales as that starting point of engagement in their Christmas shopping and that kickstart of this season. And so it's an exciting time for some retailers that have had a really rough couple of years.
Are you going to do some Black Friday sale shopping, Soph?
I may partake. I haven't actually looked at anything yet, but sometimes it's too good of a sale not to miss.
Yes, and I am one of the 2 in 5 for sure. Like, I was thinking about maybe starting my Christmas shopping the other day, and I was like, I might just hold off for a little bit until just to see as if I'm what I'm intending to purchase is going to be on sale. So I'm one of the living statistics, which is always fun to go, oh yeah, identify with that stat that we've done. In light of all of this, in light of the fact that online shopping is here to stay, that the future of shopping centres still have a place but repurposed in the future as a result of our behaviour change, how Australians, you know, feel about their finances, what they plan to do with maybe some of their savings moving forward. I've got one final question for you. So for a bit of an application, maybe if anyone is listening to this episode who might be a retailer or someone who creates products, what should companies or organizations be aware of as us as consumers, as we become more digital? What do people need to be aware of in terms of how they create those products, how they market those products in a more digitally integrated world?
I think what you've just said there, the digitally integrated world, is the key part of this question, that as consumers, as people, digital has integrated into every single area of our lives. And we are seeing a growing desire for personalization in our digital purchases, but we're also seeing that desire for frictionless experiences that, I feel like in some ways our patience has gone down, that, you know, technology of something doesn't work the first time, the frustration comes up. But it's across all areas of life, from no matter the organization that we're engaging with, whether that's a bank, whether it's a shopping store where we're purchasing our shoes, or even a store that we're purchasing our groceries from, with the interaction between what we do in our day-to-day life using the digital platform to connect and that integration, there is that growing expectation for it to be frictionless. And so I believe as organizations, how to kind of set yourself up in this time is to really start with that digital experience first. That's not the add-on, but that is the starting point. And then we build from there around how we create that frictionless experience, so it's an enjoyable experience for people to interact with us as an organization.
That's such great advice. And it's so true what you said. I think the digital world and the digitally integrated world that all of us live in and shop in and consume in is changing our expectations as consumers. We expect greater personalization of services and immediacy. And, you know, I know that you and I share in our presentations when we're trying to sort of bring this to life in a keynote or a conference, this meme where we talk about, you know, you're desperate for an answer when you have to look at the second page of Google. And whenever I share that or you share that, I know everyone's like, so true, because we always expect, you know, the most relevant immediate response to be at the top. And that kind of filters down even just from Google searches or our Spotify playlists or Netflix recommendations, where everything is personalized and it's instant. I think that does have an impact on us as consumers and how we expect to shop and the immediacy and the relevance of things that we engage with. It's important, I think, as the world changes, that organizations just be aware of that, be aware that consumers and customers are becoming more digital. And like you said, how you can have that frictionless, seamless, very simple way of people purchasing online is really going to have a great impact in the future for these organizations. Well, thank you so much, Soph, for the amazing insights and for sharing so many stats in this episode with such clarity and story and just making them really easy and accessible. It's a delight, as always, to have you on, and I so look forward to having you back again soon.
So do I. I believe we might even be on for a Christmas special, which I am very much looking forward to.
Oh, yes, that is going to be a treat for you and me, let alone the listeners. So very much looking forward to that. And as I think our listeners should be as well, very excited to have you on again for the Christmas special. So thank you again, Soph. And looking ahead, we have, as always, before the Christmas episode, some great episodes coming up in between, featuring our new research, our latest trends and insights to talk about. So if you're curious to find out more about the future, you can always subscribe to our Future Report podcast. You can watch the video recordings on YouTube. You can visit McCrindle.com, where we've got a lot of insights there. And you can also follow us on socials. And also make sure you hit follow on Spotify or Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to your podcasts, so that you can get updated on when we release a new episode, which we do every Wednesday. And if you're enjoying the podcast, we'd also love for you to leave a review on Apple Podcasts so that more people can find out about the future and the trends and the insights delivered in an engaging way. So thank you again for listening, and bye for now.